Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text is taken from our gospel lesson, Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 through 46, as read a few moments ago. Dear fellow redeemed in Christ. There has been a lot of worrying around the church office recently, a lot of concern about the future. What's going to happen? We wonder. How can we, as a staff of Mount Calvary Lutheran Church, carry on with the ministry that God has given to us? There's been a lot of talk about the end, the doom and gloom that has been hanging over our heads as we contemplate the future of our existence. What has been causing such consternation, you ask? Well, it isn't the budget we just passed a few weeks ago and how we're going to meet that budget. No, what's been really bothering the staff is something of greater impact. You see, a couple weeks ago, our beloved DCE Molly turned 25 years old. It was her quarter-life crisis, she said. Yeah, times were sure bleak leading up to that November day. But Molly, where are you, Molly? You've made it. You made it to 25 years old and beyond now, beyond. You've put 25 years way back in the rearview mirror like so many of us gathered here this morning. And contrary to what you perhaps thought, there is life after 25. Of course, I say these things tongue in cheek. Well, sort of. You see, for many people, there isn't life after 25. Not a single day of our life is guaranteed. Walk through any cemetery, and you are bound to see many dates, the dates of people who have died before their 25th birthday. And so, as we enter into the last Sunday of the church year today, it is important that we all take time and reflect upon the end. It is important that we come to grips with it. You see, one day, we all will stand before our Maker. One day, we will all have to give an account to face one of two possibilities: either eternal salvation or eternal damnation, and nothing in between. Right now, it may be the furthest thing from your mind, but in reality, it just might be closer than you think. What we have before us in our gospel reading for today is a trial. It is really a trial of faith, although one might suppose that this is a trial of works. Jesus does talk an awful lot about works, after all, but we are not called to just simply scan the text. We are called to study it, to dive into it, to analyze every aspect of the text, to read, mark, and inwardly digest it, as our old hymnal said. And when you do, you soon realize that this is indeed a trial of faith. In fact, this is a little different. This trial is a little different than what we might normally think of when we hear the word trial. Trial we are not used to. Normally we are used to seeing a trial in which there are charges that are laid out, then there's evidence that is presented. Finally, there is a judgment rendered, guilty or not guilty. But not so with this, with our text. This trial actually begins with the verdict. We are either sheep or we are not sheep. It all depends upon that verdict. It all depends upon what God declares us to be. And just what does God declare us to be? Scripture provides that answer. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. Jesus says in Mark chapter 16, verse 16, whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, and whoever does not believe will be condemned. In John 3:16, we know that verse so well, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You know, there is a word. There's a word that is used to describe God's act of forgiveness and salvation, and that word is justification. Now, the word justification simply means to declare someone not guilty. Whenever the Bible speaks of justification, it paints a picture similar to our gospel reading, a trial that is going on. This led St. Paul to write in Romans, since therefore we have been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. Brothers and sisters in Christ, trust me when I say there will be plenty of nice people in hell, fine citizens and good neighbors. But they will be lost nonetheless, because the evidence does not precede the verdict, but it follows the verdict. Christ's death was not a sham. His cross is not a stepping stone. Christ's crucifixion is everything. Notice Jesus did not say from the cross, I've got it started, now you go and finish it. No, what does he say from the cross? It is finished. It is finished. Christ's death, his cross, is the beginning and the end of your salvation, not to mention everything in between. And to make anything less of it is to reject it, to blaspheme it, to call it less than enough, to base salvation upon our feeble works or anything else less than Christ is to make our salvation cheap. And even more than that, to make it uncertain. Our text says, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Brothers and sisters in Christ, every last one of us, myself included, deserves to hear those words from the Almighty God. After all, it's what we rightly have earned as a result of our sin. The wages of sin is death, the Bible says. Our only hope of salvation resides in the verdict of God. But thanks be to God that our God is not only our maker and our judge, but he is also our Savior. When the jailer at Philippi asked Paul and Silas what he must do to be saved, they answered, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Believe in Jesus and you will be saved. If we demand to stand before God with our works, we must also stand before him with all of our works. Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, therefore, you must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. God demands absolute perfection. If you want to be saved by what you do, then you must be absolutely perfect in all that you do. And I know for certain that I am not perfect. My wife would attest to that. And I would venture to guess that neither are you. Brothers and sisters in Christ, God desires us. God desires us to be saved. He desires that no one is lost. Notice what he says in our text. To those who do not believe, he will say, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. You see, my friends, hell was not created for people. Hell was created for the devil and his angels. Jesus wants all to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. More specifically, Jesus wants you to be saved. And in him, by grace, through faith, you are saved. He has taken hold of you, and he has made you into his beloved child and an heir of his eternal kingdom. His death is your life. His life is your salvation. You are his sheep forever and ever. And what do sheep do? St. Paul answers this question in Ephesians chapter 2. After laying the groundwork by stating that we are saved by grace through faith, and this is not our own doing, rather this is a gift from God, because we are God's workmanship, St. Paul writes, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them. To paraphrase Luther, we are saved by faith alone, but faith is never alone. If you want to be saved for the love of God, don't look at your works. Look only to the love of God in Christ Jesus. In him and in him alone are you saved. In him you are brought into the flock. Do not think that looking to Jesus will have no effect upon you. Being saved means that you will produce good works, not for salvation, but because salvation is yours. Not for heaven, but because heaven is yours. Not for grace, but because grace is yours. You see, my friends, our good works could not earn 1 minute in heaven. Rather, our good works, as Molly said in her children's message, is our way of saying thank you for all that God has given to us. So there you have it, my friends. The verdict is in. You have been declared not guilty, but only through the blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Now live each day in thanksgiving to God for all that he has done, for the forgiveness, for the life, for the salvation that he gives to you this day and always. Live each day in the love of God, knowing that we deserve nothing. We deserve nothing good from him. We deserve nothing good that the Lord gives. Yet he graciously gives us anyway, out of his love. Live each day in service to God, giving all praise.